Hello, firstly, I'm going to be doing the audio for this video. Those paragraphs I've been putting up from Paint take too long to read, and my spelling is horrible anyway, so I'm doing this. Anyway, I went through Beauty and the Beast looking for subliminal messages this time, and I found quite a few. There were more in The Lion King, but there's still plenty in this one. But, I won't be putting up everything that'll come through on YouTube, only the ones that are going to be clear and obvious to everyone. Well, most everyone. If you want to see everything, if you're really that interested in dirty words and kids' movies, you know, just go watch the video for yourself. But other than that, because that won't take too long with the stuff I'm cutting out, I feel that I have to open my mouth about the bullshit, hypocritical morality that Disney injects into its videos before they go out for production. It's hilarious. They contradict themselves at every angle. It's like, alright, I'll get into it later. It'll be great.
Ma chère mademoiselle, it is with deepest pride and greatest pleasure that we welcome you tonight. And now, we invite you to relax, let us pull up a chair, as the dining room proudly presents your dinner. Be our guest, be our guest, put our service to the test. Tie your napkin round your neck, sherry, and we provide the rest. Soup du jour, hot hors d'oeuvre, why, we only live to serve. Try the gray stuff, it's delicious. Don't believe me, ask the dishes. They can sing, they can dance. After all, miss, this is France, and a dinner here is never second best. Go on, unfold your menu, take a glance, and then you'll be our guest. We our guest, be our guest. Beef ragout, cheese souffle, pie and pudding on flambé. We'll prepare and serve with flair a culinary cabaret. You're alone and you're scared, but the banquet's all prepared. No one's gloomy or complaining while the flatware's entertaining. We tell jokes, I do tricks with my fellow candlesticks.
Put it all in perfect taste that you can bear.
Come on and lift your glass, you've won your own free pass to be our guest.
If you're stressed, it's fine.
Okay, right about here, they stuck in something for about 6/100ths of a second, and this was only in the extended release version, not the original. If you haven't seen it yet, look at the man's pupils. And there are a lot of Diablo hand signs in this movie, so just in case someone doesn't know what I'm talking about out there, I'm going to include this worldly reference. Also, some of these might be a little fuzzy on YouTube. Once again, if you can't see them and would like to, have a look at the DVD.
For there's no one as curly and broad.
As you see, I've got biceps to spare.
Not a bit of him scraggly or scrawny. Not a bit of him scraggly or scrawny.
That's right.
Okay, time for the best part. My analysis of the morality in this movie. And we will start by looking at this clip from the beginning.
Once upon a time, in a faraway land, a young prince lived in a shining castle. Although he had everything his heart desired, the prince was spoiled, selfish, and unkind. But then, one winter's night, an old beggar woman came to the castle and offered him a single rose in return for shelter from the bitter cold. Repulsed by her haggard appearance, the prince sneered at the gift and turned the old woman away. But she warned him not to be deceived by appearances, for beauty is found within.
So this seems like a wholehearted, well-meant, good message for the children. It seems as if they're saying, don't judge other people by what they look like, kids. It's who you are that counts. But let's take a look at the next words the announcer says.
And when he dismissed her again, the old woman's ugliness melted away to reveal a beautiful enchantress.
So immediately after the movie talks out against this kind of judgmental definition of beauty, the announcer emphasizes it. She doesn't turn into just an enchantress, she turns into a beautiful enchantress. Beauty and the Beast, in particular of Disney's movies, spends a great deal of time emphasizing social values and benefits from being beautiful, and vice versa.
Ashamed of his monstrous form, the Beast concealed himself inside his castle.
Now it's no wonder that her name means beauty. Her looks have got no parallel.
But behind that fair facade, I'm afraid she's rather odd.
It's true, Lufu. And I've got my sight set on that one.
The inventor's daughter?
She's the one. The lucky girl I'm going to marry.
But she...
The most beautiful girl in town.
I know, but...
That makes her the best. And don't I deserve the best?
Well, of course. I mean, you do, but I'm
just... From the moment when I met her, saw her, I said she's gorgeous and I fell. Here in town there's only she who is beautiful as me. So I'm making plans to woo and marry Belle.
Look there, he goes, isn't he dreaming?
See here how we have Gaston's servant, LeFou, gazing amorously up at the village prostitutes. These women play no role in the plot, they don't need to be there, and literally all they do in this movie is perpetuate the stereotypes of male and female beauty in relationships. Let's take this scenario, for example. While they sing lustfully about how perfect Gaston is, LeFou isn't even noticed, he hasn't even looked at. They don't regard him in any way whatsoever because he doesn't fit the definition of what they're idolizing. This is so demeaning. And this message of physical beauty, in tandem with male and female interaction, is repeated time and time again in Disney's movies. This social propaganda saturates deep into our culture, as can be seen, obviously, anywhere on any magazine rack. And I'm not saying that Disney is the sole proponent of this, but only one of the larger constituents that's aimed at our children. Here are some more examples.
Are you, all right, Miss?
Megara. My friends call me Meg, at least they would if I had any friends. So, did they give you a name along with all those rippling pectorals?
Men want girls with good taste.
Oh. Obedient.
Who work fast-paced with good breeding.
And a tiny work.
You'll bring honor to us all.
Okay, point made. Disney does this in more than one movie. Now back to Beauty and the Beast.
It's no use. She's so beautiful, and I'm... Well, look at me!
Everyone's awed and inspired by you, and it's not very hard to see why.
For there's no one as curly and brawny.
As you see, I've got biceps to spare.
Not a bit of him scraggly or scrawny.
That's right. So I'm roughly the size of a barge.
Bonjour.
Good day.
Oh, is your wine?
No.
Okay, back to this one. Remember the scenario of this scene, because in a few moments I'm going to show you a clip in slow motion, and as you watch it, keep your eyes on the red girl, because you can decide whether or not this was done intentionally and or if it is subliminally influential. I love this scene in particular because it demonstrates very well how subliminal techniques are used. When I kept in mind all the subtle connotations that were going on in these few seconds, I thought to myself, fuck, the word sex popping up on the screen would be so effective for them right now. But I didn't see anything. I did know, however, that water, smoke, and fire are three mediums they love to put subliminals in because they're very twisty. So I took another look at it, and sure enough, there was one in there.